Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to Christchurch for this service of Holy Communion. We've been having problems with this microphone, so I might have to turn it off after a while. That's better. I will just speak. Good morning. This is the last of our sort of joint summer Sunday services. After, as of next Sunday, we'll be sort of reverting to the more normal pattern of three services each Sunday. So next Sunday, being the first Sunday of the month, we'll be here again at 9:30. There'll be an 11 o'clock at Hartwith and an evening service at St Saviour's at 6:30 as well. So reverting to the normal pattern. Do take those leaflets away that have been passed out about the sort of lecture series. I've been to a couple of his talks before, and they're certainly very thought-provoking. An awful lot of sort of information and thoughts sort of come at you at 100 miles an hour, and you go away sort of chewing things over. But he certainly knows his stuff, does Peter Vardy. But if you're able to get to any of those, they're a monthly lecture series. The first one is at St Cuthbert's. They're on Wednesday evenings. The first one, I think, is on the 15th of September. The date will be, no, I can't, the 15th. Whatever the date is on the back, on the yellow
side.
It just
says Wednesday.
18th. Sorry, 18th of September. But anyway, have a read of them and do support if you're able. Christine, you kindly asked me to sort of drop the numbers that the printer printed, and I didn't. So I've got a few extra of these knocking around at the back. So if you've got friends or neighbours who would appreciate a magazine, there's a sort of four or five extra at the back there. Do feel free to grab one. Also, not a notice, but a special congratulations and happy birthday to Brian. Who was 80 years young on Wednesday, so congratulations. We're going to begin our service in a moment by singing our opening hymn, which is on the extra sheets. It's called Today is the Day. Now, I've been having a little bit of trouble pitching this. But it'll either be too low or too high in the verse or the chorus, probably too low in the verse, too high in the chorus for me. Perhaps the reverse for you, I don't know. But I'll sing the first verse and chorus through to you so you become familiar with it. It's actually from the Psalms, this idea. Today is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This day is a gift that will not come again. It's utterly unique. Let's open our hearts to the presence of God. Let's stand to sing. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
As we stand, let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you, and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for the prayers of penitence as we come to God as we are. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us therefore confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon the living from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's stand to give thanks and praise to God in the words of the Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, who called your church to bear witness that you were in Christ, reconciling the world to yourself, help us to proclaim the good news of your love, that all who hear it may be drawn to you through him who was lifted up on the cross and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for our Bible reading.
First reading is from Joshua chapter 24, and can be followed on the bulletins. Then Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel, and they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to all the people, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, long ago your ancestors, Terah and his sons Abraham and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates and served other gods. Now therefore, revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. Now, if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river, or the gods the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods, for it is the Lord our God who brought us and our ancestors up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did those great signs in our sight. He protected us along all the way that we went, and among all the people through whom we went. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in this land. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Second reading is taken from Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 20. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armour of God, so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armour of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand therefore, and fasten the belt of truth around your waist, and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all these, take the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer and supplication. And to that end, keep alert and always persevere in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly, as I must speak. This is the word of the Lord.
That idea of being clothed with the armour of God, being in a spiritual battle, is taken up by a hymn that we used to sing as children in my primary school. Some of you might remember it from years ago, but it's on the sheet, "When a Knight Won His Spurs." Stand to sing. Because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died. But the one who eats this bread will live forever. He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you there are some who did not believe." But Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe and who was the one that would betray him. And he said, "For this reason I have told you, that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father." Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, "Do you also wish to go away?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Lord, open our hearts to what you would say to us through your word and by your Spirit this morning. In Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. That gospel reading sort of takes off from our gospel reading last week and the week before. It's part of quite a long meditation in John's gospel about Jesus being the bread of life, all that we need to sustain us. I'll return to that briefly at the end, but mostly I want to focus on our first two readings, particularly St. Paul's words about the armour of God. That passage is a sort of gift to Sunday school teachers, or used to be. While it's not a story, it's highly visual, and you can get children colouring pictures of Roman soldiers and labelling the different pieces of armour. And you can imagine putting the armour on, using the shield of the faith to defend yourself from flaming arrows. You might reflect on the truth, on truth being a belt, which for a Roman soldier was more an armoured skirt. It wasn't just a leather bit. It protected you from being hit in the tender parts. If you hold on to truth. The passage is quite memorable in that way, though I don't want this morning to get too hung up about sort of the allegories of what each piece of armour might mean and how we put it on, though that might well be a valuable exercise to just to take the bulletin sheet away and just sort of pray with the passage about sort of putting on these pieces of armour in our hearts. What does that mean? What does it mean to us? But I'd rather like to focus this morning on the bigger picture of why Paul thinks we might want armour in the first place. He starts this little passage by saying, "Finally," and it's him winding up his letter, actually drawing to some conclusions. He says, "Put on the whole armour of God, so that you may be able to take your stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh," as Jesus said. Flesh is not the point, the spirit is. "But against rulers, against the authorities, against cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places." We are in a spiritual battle, he said, not a material one. Now, I think the last thing Paul wants us to do is now to start asking for more details about the spiritual forces of evil. Start obsessing about demons and spirits and blaming our moral failings on them, or blaming our difficulties and struggles on invisible forces, and thereby becoming afraid. If Paul thought any more detail other than those phrases that he uses was important, I think he would have given it. His point is, we are in a spiritually hostile environment and we need to be defended. If it helps you to think of that hostile environment in terms of devils and spirits, okay, as long as it doesn't lead to fear. Paul's wider point is, that if we are in Christ, we have no need to fear. The last thing the general wants is his troops getting obsessed and over-imaginative about the special powers and abilities of their enemy. That's bad for morale. He wants them to focus on being prepared, on getting their armour and weapons in trim, on being trained for what they have to do. But when I say we're in a spiritual battle, I don't think you necessarily need to think of it in those terms of devils and spirits, if that doesn't help you. That can distract us from other much more ordinary spiritual dangers that we encounter every day. The Germans have a word, Zeitgeist, but literally it's time ghost or time spirit, or the spirit of the age, really. The ghost of the time, the spirit of the age. The spiritual forces that are around us all the time. In a sense, we are in battle with that, with the spirit of the age, the spirit of materialism, perhaps, which affects and infects us all, the spirit of cynicism about spiritual matters, the spirit of lust that makes us see and define people in terms of how sexually attractive they are and not value them if they're not, don't fit a certain norm. All these things come at us all the time through advertising, through television, through the attitudes of everyone around us, and they're hard for us to notice. But in a sense, these are spiritual forces of evil, and they're very real. They're not sort of flesh and blood in the sense that you can get your hands on them, but they really affect our daily lives. It's perhaps hard for us to see the spiritual powers that be, the authorities or cosmic powers of our own place and time, because they're so all-pervasive. But if you look at another place and time, sometimes it's easier, I think, to see what I'm talking about, what I think Paul is talking about, really. What was it, for a striking example, an extreme, that seemed to drive a whole nation mad in 1930s Germany? We might think, well, we would never have fallen for Nazism, and I hope you'd be right. But millions of otherwise intelligent and moral Germans did. It was as if the whole nation was possessed by demons. You could talk of social and economic forces or the work of the devil, about propaganda and lies. In a sense, it's all interwoven. It's hard to define, but very real. And you could look across the world at many different societies and think, no, have they gone mad? Can't they see what they're doing is just completely bonkers? And I said, well, no, they can't, because there's a sort of spirit of the age in their culture, in their hearts. And we have our own spirits of that sort, I'm sure. As I said, hard to define, but very real. What are those forces, those cosmic powers to which we are subject or are in danger of being subject, or for which we need this armour of God to protect us from? To come at it from a slightly different angle, we might compare the rulers and the spiritual forces that Paul is talking about with the other gods that Joshua will not serve in our first reading. In a sense, they were like the cosmic powers that the Amorites and the people around them believed in, and in some ways were quite real. And I don't mean that there were necessarily real conscious beings out there called the Amorite gods, but the gods that they worshipped, the spiritual forces of their age, if you like, of their culture, were about them. Joshua would not serve them. The Israelites were about to settle in the promised land. And he summons them to think about whether they will continue to serve the Lord, Yahweh, the I am who I am of Moses. Or will they serve the gods of their past, of their ancestors? Or will they serve the gods of the society around them? It was a common and perhaps normal idea in the ancient world that you needed to appease the local deities in order to prosper. They tended to believe that certain spiritual forces or gods prevail in certain localities, and that to survive and succeed, we needed to fit in with those gods, those spiritual realities, when in Rome, do as the Romans do. But it isn't as fantastical as it sounds. When you are in the midst of a culture, on the whole, you do as people around you do. You think as people around you do, and it's hard not to. We may not believe in spiritual beings, in multiple gods, in the way that the Amorites did, but we do believe in the things those gods stood for. We may not go to the temples of the gods of our ancestors, but we do pass on the ways and attitudes of our ancestors. We may not worship golden idols, but we do find ourselves fitting in with a materialistic society around us. When you put it like that, Joshua's challenge actually starts to look more tricky. Will you turn away from what you have known in the past and the ways of the society around you and serve the Lord? When you put it like that, those spiritual authorities and cosmic powers are revealed to have a greater hold on us than we thought. But how do we avoid serving them? What does it mean to don the armour? What is the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation? How do we take up the shield of our faith against these spiritual forces about us? How do we fasten on the belt of truth and discern the lies of materialism when everyone else sees them as self-evident truths? It's an ongoing spiritual battle, and it lasts a lifetime, I think. Not a magic wand that we sort of pray once and Lord protect you with the armour of God and then it's all done. It goes on and on. One example of someone who, to my mind, utterly rejected the norms of society around him in order to replace them with the gospel was, and again I use a sort of extreme example to make the point, but I think it's also quite inspiring, it's the St. Francis of Assisi in the 13th century. Their society was very materialistic. A new merchant class coming up. His father was a cloth merchant. And yet, in the midst of this society, Francis embraced poverty. There's a law of physics that I think applies to the soul. No two objects can occupy the same space at the same time. You put Archimedes in the bath and it flows, you know. One thing must displace another. If your heart is crammed tight with material things, a thirst for wealth, or the comfort or security it can get for you, there will be no room left for God. Jesus put it almost exactly like that when he said, you can't serve both God and mammon. The word mammon, he personified money as a god, as a spiritual cosmic power. St. Francis of Assisi embraced poverty because he wanted a void in his life. He wanted space that could only be filled with Jesus. But poverty wasn't a burden for him. It was a path to freedom. We never know that Jesus is enough until that's all we've got left, I think. Living acquisitively, getting stuff, isn't what life is about. It's a lie of the society around us. It's the God we often worship. It's the zeitgeist of our age, and most ages actually. It's one of the cosmic powers we're up against. You could say it's a lie of the devil. Here's a statistic I read the other day. I've heard it before. The United States of America consists of 5% of the world's population. It consumes 40% of the world's resources. And we are not much better in Europe either. In a sense, we're demonically possessed by materialism and hyper-consumption. And Christians are caught up in this system too, in this worship, as you might call it, as anybody else. Perpetuates the lie that says, the more you have, the happier you'll be. But we know, we don't believe that, do we? Christians don't believe that. We say we don't. Sometimes betray us. Our neighbours might look at us and say, you say you're citizens of a different kingdom, that you're just as consumed by shopping and money and cars and clothes and holidays and houses as we are. What's the difference? Why should we take the gospel seriously? I'm challenging myself on this one as much as anybody else, because it's all around us. We've been brought up in it. I think we need to be liberated from the need to find meaning and security in mammon. We need to don our armour, take up our arms against it, instead of going with the flow. So what? Should we all, like Francis, just give away all our possessions, and like the first disciples did? On one level, why not? But I think we might find that tricky. But at least we can make a start by acknowledging and repenting of our materialism, of noticing the forces that have this impact on us. And then we can seek to live more simply. Trust that Jesus really is enough. Really is all we need. He really is the bread of heaven. And let go. We really don't need the things we think we need to make us happy and content and secure. Jesus really is all you need to find meaning and joy in life. The worship of other gods that Joshua was turning away from, and indeed all the things those gods stood for, it's about trying to be in control. People worshipped these multiple deities because they controlled different aspects of their lives, be it wealth, be it winning in battles, be it having fertility and having children and having crops growing. It was a way of trying to control a world that they couldn't really control. Joshua is saying, in a sense, you can't control it. Let go. Trust God. If anyone's in control, it's God. Why is it we want money? Most of it's about wanting to be in control of our lives. It's an illusion, this control, but if we think we have enough, then we'll just, you know, we'll feel a bit more secure. And what Joshua is calling people to, what Jesus called people to, and Paul is calling people to, it's radical trust in God. Trust that God is in control. Everything that really matters. And Paul starts his talk about armour by saying, be strong in the Lord, in the strength of his power. In other words, find your strength and security in God, not in all the other things that you might be tempted to rely on, the gods of this world around us, not in our own power. We might think we're not tempted to rely on other gods because we don't believe they exist. But, as I said, we are often caught up in the things that they stood for. All the physical things we rely on won't defend our minds and hearts from the spiritual dangers. The things that will rescue us from the slavery of the spiritual forces around us are, as Paul says, righteousness, truth, our salvation. Our sword is the word of God. Paul says, put on the whole armour. I don't leave a bit of it off, because that would be what your enemy aims for. To finish, how does that relate then to the gospel reading? Well, where do we get this armour from? The soldier presumably gets it from his regiment, from his commanding officer. Elsewhere, Paul says, clothe yourselves with Christ. Ultimately, Jesus Christ is our armour. He has won our salvation. He is our salvation. There's a helmet. He is our righteousness. Paul says that Christ is our righteousness. That's your breastplate. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and that there's the belt. Our shield is our faith in him. He is the word of God in the flesh. It all boils down, ultimately, Jesus. He is all we need. He is what we need to receive. He is the bread of heaven. A lot to chew over there. Perhaps should we just take a moment of prayer and ask for God's help in donning that armour against what we need to page 8, we find the words of the Creed, a declaration of faith in God, Christ in the Spirit. Let's stand to declare the words together. We believe in one God,
the Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory, to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated for our prayers. Power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. Father God, Heavenly Lord, open our hearts to you and to trust in you and you alone. Open our eyes. Things that would draw us away from you, that would get in between us and you, that would ask for our worship, that would ask for our time and our effort, and distract us from you. Give us grace to receive your protection, your salvation, your righteousness, your truth. Equip us with faith and trust in you. And help us to take up your word. And live the good news of the gospel of peace in our world. Forgive us where we have been too entangled. The culture around us. And though we in many ways can't help it, give us grace, step by step, day by day, to live lives more closely with you, Lord Jesus. Give us your spirit and your strength for this battle in which we are in. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for your church here and throughout the world. Give grace to Nick and Anna, our bishops, to all who lead your church, the churches in the dale around us and in our nation, and across the world in so many different situations. Assailed by different problems, we pray for the church in Buhemba in Tanzania. We pray pray for the churches in Ukraine, in Israel, in Sudan. Lord, open our hearts to our brothers and sisters, wherever they may be. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We hold before you those situations we see in our world that we feel so powerless to do anything about. We continue to pray for the whole Middle East, for a way of peace, or at least of calming things. We continue to pray for Syria, for Sudan, for Ukraine, and pray for your peace in our world. But we also pray for all the nations where so many people are caught up in the love of material things, for all those who get left out of that race and scrabble, for those who live in poverty in our own nation and throughout the world. We pray for all seeking to bring relief, for those seeking to build and change economies and situations. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we hold before you all who suffer and struggle. We hold before you those known to us, whether locally or far away. We think especially of Joan and Brian Dean, Alison Bradley, Judith Wilson, Molly Kendall, Barbara Rosewell, Paul Eckersley, Laurie Dodds, Tony Hutchinson, Anne Metcalf, Tony Atwood, Rainer Kitsing, Joshua, and Paul Heap. And in a moment of quiet, let's offer our own prayers for any we know who need them now. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We also hold before you those who have died, thinking especially of Georgia Brown and Alison Waterworth and their families and friends in their sorrow. Hear our prayer. And finally, let us offer to God ourselves and all that concerns us, all that we are thankful for, and all that troubles us. We pray for this coming week, the things that are ahead of us, whether they're things we're looking forward to or quite the reverse. We ask that we face all of them in Christ's strength. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. In the communion, we come as ever to receive from Christ. To receive symbolically his body, his blood, himself, all that he stands for. We can also think of receiving the armour that he would give us as well. I think as we come to him, what is it we want to receive from him today? Ultimately, it is himself that you need, but there may be other things on your hearts as well. But now let's stand for the peace. Christ has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share in his peace. Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of Christ's peace. Our offertory hymn is number 219 in the Red Books. Soldiers of Christ, arise and put your armour on. Let's say together the offertory prayer. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendour and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and only of your own do you live. The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praises.
It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son.
You embraced us as your children, and welcomed us to sit and eat with you.
In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us.
He opened his arms of love upon the cross, and made for all the perfect sacrifice of sin.
On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life.
At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all.
As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son.
As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord.
With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
And as our Saviour Jesus Christ has taught, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us.
Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us peace.
Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith, with thanksgiving.
Most merciful Lord, your love compels us to come in. Our hands are unclean. Our hearts are unprepared. We were not fit even to eat the crumbs under your table. But you, Lord, are the God of our salvation, and share your bread with sinners. So cleanse and feed us with the precious body and blood of your Son, that he may live in us and we in him, and that we, with the whole company of Christ, may sit and eat in your kingdom. Amen.
Body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. Creator. You feed your children with the true manna, the living bread of heaven. Let this holy food sustain us through our earthly pilgrimage, until we come to that place where hunger and thirst are no more, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace and opened the gates of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Final hymn is number 343 in the hymn books, Be Thou My Vision. Son Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Do stop for refreshments if you are able. One of those beauties, I don't have to rush off today. I do eventually, but not yet. Then let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen.